We're back. Or are we?
I'm Ed. I don't know what you're talking about.
I'm Rick.
You got it.
There you go.
I can't see a damn thing without my glasses on for distance, so I got to have my glasses back.
Well, I had the placeholder before lunch,
well,
right?
Well, now the replica has finished.
Yes.
And so now you have a full synchronized copy that's about 50 minutes behind for...
It's about 50 minutes behind for...
Two dark shirts, it's hilarious.
Two dark shirts, it's hilarious.
Oh, now you're going to repeat everything.
Now you said I'm behind. Okay. I'm a replica.
Nice.
All right, enough of that.
Welcome back to the 417 Jumpstart. We're going to be talking about implementing direct access. I just about said it. Dynamic access controls.
You did say it,
I did say it, dynamic access controls in this particular module coming up. But I wanted to first of all share with you one thing. In the very first module today that we were talking about, module 7, we introduced the concept of we threw this at the producers to see if they'd be interested. Ed and I are going to give you a little bit of a bonus section at the end of module 12, so stick around. You're going to help.
Okay.
You're not leaving.
All right.
You're paid up till 4 o'clock or whatever it is.
What time zone?
I don't know. We're going to give you a bonus section about how to...
Nice.
About how to prepare for a Microsoft exam, certification exam. In this case, we're talking about the 417. Some tips and tricks that we've had over the years writing exams. My first exam that I wrote, Windows 3.1.1 and DOS 62 for support professionals.
You got me beat.
I know what the defrag/B switch means, which was an exam question. I can tell you that because now the exam's been retired.
Is that the bonus defrag?
No, that is the reboot on completion.
There you go.
So... yes, that was my first exam ages ago. They've obviously evolved a lot over the years.
We could just take the whole afternoon and do this.
They've evolved over a large number of time over the years, a large space over a number of years. And we thought it'd be useful for you guys that are attending this particular Jumpstart just to look at some additional resources about the actual technical content, but also some strategies on how to prepare for the exam. So stay with us right after Module 12. We will have that information for you. And then a note for the editors, just so you guys know, if you could, we're going to leave you a little second pause or two to be able to do a splice and make that guy stand out on his own. So that is my piece about this afternoon.
All right.
Or this evening or whatever time it is where you are after module 12.
For the morning.
You got it.
For this morning.
So this is dynamic access control. And this is something that is new with Server 2012. It is something that is not necessarily... a functionality or a new capability that you're going to dive right into.
No.
And I'll mention it with caution. With great power comes great responsibility. I love to say that quote. You have the ability, obviously,
to... I have to come back as Spider-Man after the break, don't I?
That'll be funny. You have the responsibility of protecting the data that resides on your servers and ensuring that only the proper people have access to that data, that should have access to that data. And we've come up with a variety of strategies over the years to be able to protect it. The easiest way to understand that we've always done, is basically using NTFS permissions, as well as share permissions, to look at what the effective permissions are for the individual user access.
So now we have a third
data.
One.
Now there's another layer you can add into that, which is dynamic access control, to be able to do it.
I can just picture right now, for everyone who's with us, I can just see us sitting here 4 years from now with server blah, blah, blah. And, we're going to be talking about dynamic access control and how there's this easy wizard now for this really cool thing that was introduced in Windows Server 2012.
Nice.
I can see it. I can see it right now.
Nice.
And by the way, before you get anything back into it, I'm being asked by our producers to make sure to remember to look for those polls this afternoon.
Yeah, so if you're in full screen mode, drop out to the webpage once in a while. There's a live poll there right now. Talking about, I believe, the Jumpstart, how you guys are finding it for exam prep.
I can't see the poll. I'm in full screen.
I know.
So.
I can't see either.
I can just see you.
So we're going to get started.
All right.
Module 10. Right, flip over the slides here, bud. Implementing dynamic access control. This is module 10. We got two more to go after this one here. First off, basically, what is dynamic access control and how do you plan and implement it? And then finally, going off and configuring dynamic access control. There is a brief demo in this one here I'll be adding in there near the very end, but most of this is just conceptual because it is new and because it is something that is a big shift that you can now add into. It's a pivot you can add into how you're going to be protecting your resources.
Well, and there's honestly probably 8 hours worth of demo we could show because there's just that much, and it's that, that's why we're not going to dive in
Yeah.
100%. That meaning
we could use whiteboards and have discussion topics around stuff.
So we could do a whole jumpstart on it.
So you know what? What is dynamic access control? It is another way to provide secure file server-based access through resources to any and all file server-based resources. The challenge is, and this is a little caveat you need to know, is that obviously dynamic access control is only going to be available on file servers that are running Server 2012.
Yes.
It's used for protecting resources that are file and directory-based on local systems. It gives you the ability to go off and basically identify and classify data on your systems, on your local file servers at rest. You're able to control access to files with a variety of different expressions now, as opposed to simply, do you have group membership or not, and that's it. You also can have a better view of the auditing for files, potentially, much more granular, as opposed to linking that to NTFS permissions. And then finally, you have the ability to throw on the extra layer of doing RMS protection as well. So again, some of these things are going to be too much in depth to be able to cover for this particular module, but you are going to want to read up on how they work. We're going to be covering the basic ideas of what is dynamic access control, how to work with it, and what you can use it for. Now, to be able to support and work with access control, obviously we're going to be working with a variety of network protocols that are on our servers. So basically, we're going to be using Active Directory, you're going to be using claims-based authentication, possibly for identifying who those individual users are. You have to have a working DNS, working Active Directory. This is all like typical stuff that you would normally see on any system that's out there, right? We're going to be using Kerberos tickets on our systems. We're going to be obviously involved in working with security descriptors and access control entries and access control lists. File classifications is something new that we're going to be talking about, and also some auditing stuff as well.
Fun stuff.
Yeah.
A lot of fun stuff.
Any comments there? No? We're good?
There's plenty of comments, but they're all about the green hat. So
there we go.
Go ahead.
First off, I've got a file folder. It's up on a server, Ed. I want to protect it.
Why?
Because I don't want to have everyone having access to this. I don't want to have the everyone equals full control set up for this.
All right.
So how would you go about protecting that?
Is it shared?
Could be.
Well, then I'm going to use NTFS and shared permissions, shared folder permissions.
Now, do you follow the suit?
Right.
Do you follow the suit of basically leaving your share permissions open and then locking with NTFS?
Of course, because I've been doing this since the old days when that's all we did.
Or do you actually get granular with your share permissions and then granular with your NTFS as well?
You know what? I will tell you that I am kind of that old school, leave the share wide open and control everything with NTFS. That's not the recommended way, but that is, unfortunately, my way. That is how I do it.
I do more of a hybrid where I actually go in and I put some permissions on the share, obviously, that I do and do not want to have access to, and then I do the rest of my stuff with NTFS. We also now have the ability, well, we had it also in 2008 or two. Did you have it in 2008? Access-based enumeration? I'm trying to tickle your brain.
And I'll tell you what, you can tickle all you want. The difference between what was introduced in 2008 and what was introduced in R2 is probably one of the biggest tripping moments
cloudy areas
that I can
have. Either way, the concept was basically you could go in and based on your access enumeration when you attached up to it, if you were allowed to have access to the file, you would actually see the file folder in the file. If you didn't, then you would not be able to see it. I'm actually thinking I might go back to 2003. But I'm gonna leave that to the people in the answer form and talk about
it. It's
that
safe if you leave it to 2003 because
it's phased out. It's going to be phased
out. You know for sure it was not there. 2008 versus R2, maybe.
You got it.
But we can safely use 2003 as our example.
So all that would do is simply hide what was visible. Because other networking environments that were popular in the day, Novell as an example, they had the ability to go off and restrict what you actually saw when you attached up to one of their shares. But at our point, when we had stuff, it was open to everyone to be able to see it, even if you had no access.
Right. So you're basically saying that you were using share permissions to
restrict
make it that
people
couldn't see stuff that they couldn't get to, as opposed to my way is a very good point. They'll see every single share that's out there because they have full control of the share. They just won't be able to open the stuff because it's been locked.
But then you could have turned on access-based enumeration and then hidden some of the stuff.
Exactly.
Too.
But we're not sure if it was 2008 or R2.
The main thing we're trying to get at here is NTFS permissions and also share permissions. There is an order of operations. Obviously, you get disqualified or granted access to your shares. After that, it's basically down to the individual file folder and objects you're trying to access to with your ACLs, your access control lists, and your access control entries, which are your SIDs, group memberships, individual users that are at the ACLs and at the access control entries. The most restrictive if I remember correctly, the most restrictive. I'm looking at you to double check.
Oh, I can do this one in my sleep.
Access denied, you're out. You're done. You don't have access to it. And right. then?
Well, it depends. Because, again, and this is again, a real hang-up with a lot of people, and that is that within shared permissions or within NTFS permissions, it's actually the least restrictive when you're just trying to come up with your, if you're a member of multiple groups and all that good stuff. But when you combine your share and NTFS together, it's the most restrictive or the more restrictive of the resultant share permission and the resultant NTFS permission. So if we just look at it as...
It reminds me of math that I failed at high school,
and that's
right?
why it's easy for me and because I'm a math tutor, right? So, the way I always tell everyone to look at it is if you think of the share permissions, do what you have to do to figure out what your end result or what we have learned to call effective share permission yep. is, and do whatever you have to do to figure out what your effective NTFS permission is. Take those two, and it is the more restrictive. I always say more because most, to me, means you have more than two. So maybe once we add DAC into it, then we can get there. But I almost said direct access also. once we add the dynamic access control into it, we have three, right? We can say most. But with the two, it's the more restrictive. So if one is read-only and one is full control, you're getting read-only.
Got it.
All right.
Now, we're harping on this just, again, to bring back the historical aspect of what's going on with security because it does come into play.
An additional
layer, it's still in play. Additional security also can come from the introduction of using RMS protection. RMS protection allows you to basically have the control of the documents while they're in motion, while they leave your environment, while they're on your environment, basically who has access to them, are they encrypted, are they not encrypted, and then what the rights are for that individual to do something to that document once they've opened it because of their ACLs. Once they have actually opened it, can they read it, can they modify it, can they copy it, and can they save it, and that sort of stuff. So that's when it's in motion, if you will. Dynamic access control basically gives you an extra layer of access control based on claims that are attributes. And what object in our networks has a whole plethora of attributes that is generally underutilized, except for group memberships and users? I gave you a hint right there. What is a whole whack of attributes?
You're asking me?
Yeah.
I thought we were waiting for all the answers to come through.
No. What is it?
I don't know where you're going, dude.
Who has all sorts of objects that have a slew of attributes that are probably not filled in? That is centrally located, uses the primary security. What
groups?
Uses sit inside? What do they sit inside?
OUs.
What does OU sit inside?
A domain.
And what does a domain sit inside?
A forest.
And what's a forest inside?
Your head. My goodness.
What's the service? What's the service that runs all this? What is it? The role? What is it? Just say the words. Starts with...
Just say it.
Active Directory, dude. Come on. I was looking for... Maybe I led him down the wrong path.
You know what? Everyone out there, just bust on me like crazy with the Q&A. I don't care. Where was he going?
I'm trying to get down to the fact that, hey, dynamic access control gives you the ability...
Next hour, we're going to play charades.
For... Two words, sounds like active directory.
Directory.
You got it. Values of specific attributes. So I can basically now finally light up
you're
my
for
department.
The schema? Is that what you're going for?
No, I was just trying to say, what is active directory?
Okay.
It lights up specific attributes. You don't fill in country. You don't fill in department. You don't fill in employee type unless you go
Those
in
are
and effort.
User
and do
them. Attributes.
Right, but they're attributes and stored inside the Active Directory.
Okay.
They also can be computer-based attributes that you identify and highlight and update, but they're not security ACLs, so I can't use them as part of an access control entry. They don't exist. I can't use them. Only groups, users, and individual SIDs basically can sit there with our current structure. So AD can now provide the attributes that allow you to use dynamic access control because you can make a claim against your object inside the Active Directory. Very long tangent, just to be able to say that.
Okay. And I'm laughing because everyone is busting on me just as I asked them.
There you
to.
Go. Yes. You got it. So with your identity, the concept is basically, in the past we're used to saying, okay, I authenticate to my workstation, I authenticate then to the Active Directory, I find my domain controller, I log on, it builds me my access token is built up with my SIDs that I belong to from group membership on my individual SID, right? That's
right.
All common stuff we've always been doing. The difference now is that I'm an authenticated user, and I'm able to go in and go off and talk to an individual server and say, hey, this is me. I want to go off and have access to this share. And it goes off and looks at my access token and says, yes or no. Am I allowed to have access to the share? Yes, okay. NTFS for the file object. Do I have access to it? Yes or no. Okay, good. You got it. Done. think of an identity more than just using access to, with SIDs and with groups and entries. Think of it as like, you know, if I'm going to buy some alcohol, or if I want to go off and drive, I need to be able to prove that I can drive, and the policeman pulls me over or something like that. And he looks at me and he says, can I have some ID, please? And I show him my Canadian passport. He will take that as good proof that I can.
You're in bad shape at that point.
Or I could show him my Canadian driver's license or my U.S.-based driver's license, whatever. Uh-huh. I show him a form of identity, and that identity is basically a trusted identity that is says that who I am, how old I am, where I live, and am I allowed to drive or not in the state of Washington.
Still doesn't give you permission to drive drunk.
Well, good thing
Canadian
I'm not.
Canadian or another. Or
it's a good
otherwise.
Thing I'm not. Good thing I'm not. So. It then basically is able to say, is this a trusted authority from someone I believe that is trustworthy issuing? So that would be the government of Canada, the state of Washington, mm-hmm. The province of Ontario. And then does it have the attribute that says he's allowed to drive? And, you know, does he have the attribute that says he must wear glasses to be able to drive and stuff like that? So basically there are attributes that are on that particular ID card, my claim that says I am Rick Claus, mm-hmm. I'm allowed to drive in the state of Washington to be able to go off and to drive.
Can I see it?
My wallet's not here. I'm sorry. Okay. I can't
help you. I was going to show them.
So basically, wouldn't it be nice to be able to have the ability to say, hey, I'm accessing this file, and besides, here's all my group memberships. This file is sensitive information and should only be seen by full-time employees. Currently, I have to have an elaborate group scheme that I put objects into that belong to that group that identifies that person as a full-time employee. Instead, what I could do is I could simply flip a tiny attribute bit inside my Active Directory that says employee type, and it changes to FTE for full-time employee, PTE for part-time employee, or C for contract, or whatever it happens to be.
No, C's for Canadian.
Canadian. CDN. You basically are identifiable by the attributes that are inside there and use that as a claim. So basically, that's claims-based authentication for having additional attributes you can now light up. And once they're lit up, you can then apply them to individual file shares. That's the long roundabout way of saying this is what dynamic access control is building up to.
Right.
It's internal to your organization. This isn't talking about federation. That's later. This is internal to your organization.
Which, by the way, that's what one person said that they thought you were going for.
No.
They thought you were going for a federation, not for Active Directory.
So basically, claims are statements that are made by the Active Directory service about a specific user or computer object in the Active Directory. Mm-hmm. I have to light up and turn on what those claim types are. So basically not every single attribute is available. I choose which ones I want to make them lit up. And then I also define what the possible answers are going to be for what those things happen to be. And then I have to put in some kind of a process to be able to fill in those attributes with the proper information. It can be automated, can be user implemented, can be PowerShell changed, can be, you know, done with a Microsoft Identity Server or you know, FIM, Forefront Identity Manager, whatever it happens to be. It can go in and populate that data as required to be able to do it. So Active Directory Services basically with 2012 supports user claims and device claims. And before anyone starts to ask, you know, what are the requirements to be able to do this, you have to have a 2012...
IPv6?
No IPv6.
No? Okay.
You have to have a Server 2012 domain controller, mm-hmm. And you have to have Server 2012 file servers that are using these new dynamic access controls, claims-based restrictions placed on them, or expressions, basically. Okay? Those are the requirements. Your end-user access piece, the client you're using, could be anything, but it has to be, for a user-based claim, has to be Windows 8.
Can you have a mixed environment of domain controllers?
You can, but the file servers running Server 2012 will only talk to a domain controller 2012 to be able to do this. So you want to make sure you have enough of them out there to be able to do it.
But
there's no force functional changes.
Correct.
No domain functional changes. This is simply having the schema updated to be able to support Server 2012 domain controllers and then having them implemented.
Right, but and that's an interesting caveat to this whole thing. I shouldn't even say caveat. I think that's a feature to this whole thing, is that you don't have to have all Windows Server 2012 domain controllers. Only the 2012 domain controllers will actually acknowledge this.
Yeah.
But it will function without having to bring all of your previous...
So from a design implementation perspective, just make sure in the sites where you have your Server 2012 systems, file servers running, make sure you've got 2012 domain controllers in the same site. Otherwise, they're going to go across the network to be able to go off and find
them. Yeah, which isn't going to be fun. Right. You're not going to want to do that.
So back over here, this whole concept, you understand the concept of where claims are coming from and where they're stored. They have to be lit up first with different types, and then you have to make other things. How do you get these deployed? So basically, you
I
have...
asked Rick to do it.
You asked Rick to do it. Basically, what you're going to have is what's known as a central access policy. And the central access policy is one or more rules of what these conditions are. And the rules are basically defining your conditions. So you could say, for instance, user departments is equal to research and development, as an example. Mm-hmm. Or it could be country equals United States, or country equals Canada, or whatever it happens to be. And then you basically say, if this criteria is true, so if full-time, if employee type equals full-time and department equals R&D, these are two attributes that I've lit up, if that's equal to true, it's an and of those two things, then allow read-write for authenticated users, as an example. And then I can include that into my rule, which is then stored inside my central access policy, apply those down to my file servers, and then I can now use that as an additional layer of security on those file servers specifically to protect those resources, in addition to NTFS and to shares. So with Active Directory, basically you create your claim, and then you create your claim types, your file property definitions, and your rules to create that central policy. Once that central policy, it has to have at least one rule into it. You can have multiple rules that are created. You then have to go into Group Policy Manager and then identify to your under security file systems restrictions, central access policies. Is it lit up and turned on? And if so, if you want to, filter it for certain file servers if you wanted to. And then finding the file server, once it's done a GP update slash force and just refreshed naturally one or the other, you can then start to include this new access rule and this new central policy to whatever file share folder or whatever it is that's on your system to now respect claims that are coming in from individual users. So it's as you mentioned, maybe the next revision is going to be smoother, neater, nicer, whatever happens to be. But currently, it's a multi-step process that requires a bunch of different tools to have implemented.
And still like very said, cool, though.
Still very cool. It's not something you're going to be diving into because you have to understand the architecture and, more importantly, understand the business process for what's going on.
Well, and you know, and like you were getting at before, even though I didn't come up with Active Directory that you were going for.
Maybe I was leading down the wrong path.
How amazing is it, you know, to have all of these, you know, to get a break away from just very simple, what user are you, what group are you a member of, or what computer are you?
Yep.
And be able to utilize these thousands upon thousands of attributes.
Yep.
And this is really exciting. It really, really is. I want to be completely in, all in on this. You know, but it's a lot. You gotta walk a little carefully with it.
It's a planning thing. So yeah. Some reasons for implementing dynamic access control, very simple, as you mentioned. You're lacking the granularity for the desired results by simply mirroring your business processes. I mean, I can always remember talking about Active Directory designs and group structure and group planning to be able to say you're going to want to possibly create the groups that represent all your salespeople overall, and then you want to nest in your groups that are going to be your regional salespeople and everything else that happens to be regionally, and then also go in and then add in different other groups for different things. The problem when you have so many different types of groups, it becomes unwieldy to control them all and to keep them up to date, right? So now you can actually just simply go off the attribute. Now, also from a hindsight perspective, 2020 is hindsight, you gotta be aware that you
have
to audit.
That,
I know, I don't have hindsight. You gotta make sure that you're aware that you're auditing attribute changes. Because if someone has the right to change their attributes, like employee status, as an example, and they're just a Joe Blow person, if they go off and change their status from PT to FTE, as an example, all of a sudden I would have access to more things. So, again, granular, prime example, if I'm inside the folder share for finance and there's some sensitive financial data I should not be taking a look at, besides using RMS encryption, I could also now go in and say, give people read-only access to be able to change these results only if they have the FTE attribute listed on their claim. And if they don't have that, they get denied access.
I'm hoping that the part-timers don't have access to change attributes.
Who knows, man? You never know.
Could be part-time IT, yeah. Though, right?
So here's planning, the whole concept for planning. And this is where this is the taking out the piece of paper, talking with the business units, this is the planning aspect of it. Or basically, you have to don't just go off and implement dynamic access control willy-nilly and saying,
what it means is what happens when you fail to plan?
You plan to fail.
There you go.
Identify your business case for why you want to go off and start to implement a central access policy and how that can be structured with a variety of different types of rules. Which resources are you going to protect them that require that finer grain password control or finer grain control? The requirements have to be clearly outlined and basically understood what the process is to be able to change attributes and stuff like that. You have to potentially translate those business requirements into actual those conditional expressions, like the example of and full-time or part-time, whatever it happens to be, and then I basically go ahead and identify your claim types. Now, what I will say is there's a very good solution accelerator from the Dynamic Access Control team that you can go off and take a look at that will go through and use and light up the most appropriate attributes within your Active Directory and give you explanations for why you might want to end up using these ones as opposed to simply just looking at all the attributes for user objects and then picking which ones.
But that's more fun.
It could be more fun, but it could be.
I created a dartboard.
A dartboard for how you plan? Let's light up
that attribute.
Custom attribute number 17.
Yes.
Because it means so much. So yes, make sure to do your planning. There's a good section talking about this on the online website and also from white papers talking about dynamic access control.
Do you really think that it's the kind of thing that's going to be implemented on a, you know, only certain resources basis? Or do you think that that's going to evolve into the future of how we access all our resources?
I think it's going to be a combo. Just like how we're doing combo right now with different approaches to how you're going to be handling your shares mm-hmm. and your NTFS permissions currently, your approach to the way you do it is different than mine, which is different than everyone else's that's on this particular jumpstart right now. And so I think it's going to be a phased approach, and I mm-hmm. think it's going to be trial. Now, the best part is, I haven't talked about this just yet, is that you can actually go in and implement this in, for lack of a better term, preview mode, if you will. So basically, it'll go through, and you can put the conditional expressions in. It's basically, I think it's called proposed changes for the access access entries, mm-hmm. and it will actually just simply list an event log entry in your event logs on the file servers that says Joe accessed this file and would have been blocked because of his claim, or Sally accessed this file and was granted access because of her claim, as opposed to just NTFS stuff. So you can actually go through the business planning aspect of it, you can implement your suggestions and then simply do not enforce things, and then watch the event logs to see if the proper stuff happened. Once it's good to go, then you can flip it over for the rules perspective, centrally located, and then you can say enforce them and actually change the ACLs, and then it will go off and do that change the next group policy refresh.
Yeah, I mean, it's almost like RSOP for group policy or yep. or what if for PowerShell.
Yep.
So, and one of the points I wanted to make as far as why I ask about your thoughts on if this is going to be a hybrid versus DAX just going to take over is, as far as I'm aware, NTFS and share permissions, they're here to stay.
Yeah,
this is not a replacement, not just in Windows Server 2012, but it's been very clearly explained to me from somebody on related to the product team that those are not going away. This is not a replacement. It's an advancement.
It's an extra tool, tool to protect your stuff. Addition to this is also, besides granting and denying access to resources, is the ability to go through and change attributes on individual files. I'm not just talking about the archive bit and the read-only bit and stuff like that, but actual attributes in those files, the data classification on those files, the metadata. You can actually go in and identify file classifications as well. So you can go in and flag stuff manually as being high impact for business, for data classification, sensitive, secret, or whatever it happens to be. You can have applications go through and do that programmatically. You can have PowerShell do that programmatically. You can have individual apps that go in and make those changes as you make saves. You can have a folder structure that'll go in and simply say anything saved under this folder structure will automatically be classified as X, whatever X happens to be, because you define what those different levels happen to be. And then with File Server Resource Manager, FSRM, you can actually enable the ability to take action upon those classifications to say, oh, if this is rated as high, go ahead and set this guy up to be RMS protected. Or if this is rated as low, then do nothing. If someone flips it from high to low, then do the following. And it's even able to do that on a schedule basis, or you can even run a classifier that runs on demand. So when it finds a change on the file system inside a controlled area, it'll go ahead and do the appropriate action on that individual.
So is what you're saying that not only do we get to give access to resources based upon all the various attributes of Active Directory objects, but we can also control what objects or what resources, I should say, they get access to based upon its attributes as well?
That is correct. It can be added into the expression. So very, very cool stuff. planning really cool stuff. The addition of this, obviously, with auditing. Auditing used to only be available based on actions you were doing with NTFS-style permissions. Now, also, it can be done as well based on this. So you can basically track changes to user accounts. You can track changes to machine accounts and attributes. You get, obviously, more information from logon events. You can track changes to the central access policy. You can track changes to access rules to basically find out, now that you're using objects more detailed, in a more detailed fashion, you want to find out what's changing on those objects and who is doing those changes to be able to find out if someone's circumventing the process and changing the attributes they should not be changing. So basically, this is now planned for and available to be able to catch that. Another new thing that's available as well is the access denied assistance options. The ability to have what I call a SharePoint-like experience. When I try to access a resource, like a file folder or a share, and I get blocked for some reason, I now can basically, with FSRM, File Server Resource Manager, identify who who should be given the information about why you're being denied access, a generic piece of text, you're not supposed to, or you know, maybe something a bit more subtle, you know, try setting this, try setting that, talk to your manager, or contact, or send an email to the owner, and it will actually go through and provide an email path for you to be able to use your email client to send an email to the owner of that particular file share, and then grant you access to it. So basically, you can control the text of the email, who is going to be able to request an email get sent, who the recipients are, and also you know, which OSs can support this.
So, you know, just real quick here, quick show of hands for me, okay? Quick show of hands.
With the time
who
delay.
Who here? What?
With the time delay.
With the time. No time delay. Quick show of hands. Who here has ever spent at least an hour researching an access denied message? That's what I thought. You see it? You see those hands?
It was about 80%.
It was. I thought it was 82%, actually.
I was counting.
Can you see why we're so excited about this? Everything about this, once we get there and once you get this all in place, is going to make our lives so, so much easier and so much better when it comes to access control.
With planning of policy changes, with dynamic access control, basically, as I mentioned, it has this thing that's called proposed permissions. You can go through the exercise of doing your planning, work with your business units, you can come up with your rules, create your central policies, and apply those policies down to your individual file servers and your file folder structures, and you can implement them with what's known as proposed permissions. And then it will basically fire off an event log entry on the local box of the file server that'll go in and basically identify you as saying, hey, you tried to have access to it, you were denied, you tried to have access to it, and you were granted. Every attempt to access that resource is going to be logged in the security log of the file server. Some prerequisites for being able to do this, literally a simply matter of having server 2012. You need to have a domain controller running server 2012. Your file servers have to be running 2012 that are going to be using this new technology. And then also you're going to be using Windows 8 desktops if you're going to be doing device claims. You can actually say, on this device, which is a full-fledged laptop, grant them access to that system. If it is a Windows 8 Surface device, maybe you do not have the ability to go off and access that particular file. So you can choose what that happens to be, but it's only Windows 8 desktop that can do device.
Do you have one of those?
I do not. It's not available.
Me neither.
Yet.
You can have one
soon.
In 2 days?
You never know. My wife wanted one, but you know, that's another whole discussion about that. Enabling support for Active Directory domain services and dynamic access control. Literally, it's a matter of going into, and I'll show you this in the demo, how to set this up, is turn on by using group policy. The GPO that contains dynamic access control settings are then linked to the OU for the domain controller. Dynamic access control settings are stored inside group policy objects, which is policy, administrative template, system, KDC node, and GPO object editor. You then go in and you set up and support dynamic access control to be able to go off into protected resources. Very simple sort of stuff to do. Some extra controls. We're talking about this thing called FAST, Kerberos, otherwise known as Kerberos arming. This simply is a new stopgap that's inside, a new solution, sorry, that's inside Active Directory 2012 edition that prevents man-in-the-middle style attacks for being able to go in and to take control of your Kerberos conversation between you and your server. Implementing claims, resource property objects. Claims are basically created for users and computers. They have attributes as the source. They're created in the Active Directory Administrative Center or with PowerShell. I'll show you that in just a moment. Your property objects, resource properties, are created in resources. The properties are a source. You're able to define what those are going to be applied to down to the local file system level, like classification as an example. You also can create them in Active Directory Administrative Center. Both claims and resource property objects, or RPOs, are used in the conditional expression. So claims are basically for the users. I claim that I am apartment department so-and-so, and that my employee type is full-time, or my country is whatever. The resource property objects are what are used at the file system level for the individual files and folder structures to say, I am classified as important, as highly sensitive, as secret, or whatever happens to be, and then go off and to do stuff. So keep those two things straight. Central access allows you to manage and deploy your consistent authorization across the entire enterprise because you're using group policy applied to individual files and folders through group policy objects. The rules basically identify which your targeted resources, your permissions that you'll be applying down to, and then the conditions that are in there with the individual rules. So I'm going to come back to this in just one second. Actually, just kind of show a little bit about how to set this up.
I was going to ask if we're going to have time for this demo because there's so much to tell these guys.
No, it's actually what I'm going to show you is how to basically enable and set up for dynamic access control here. Sign in here. This is my domain controller. And if you remember correctly, I said you have to basically go off and launch your Active Directory Administrative Center to be able to do this. So right mouse click, context sensitive on my guy for Administrative Center. And in here, I'm going to go strictly, instead we were playing around before inside this area up above, or you will be in the next session, talking about managing your users and OUs and groups and stuff like that for managing the regular stuff.
Maybe.
I'm going down to this level for a dynamic access control area for the tool. Maximize this, please. Thank you. And first off, you have to basically identify what are the attributes you're lighting up. That's known as a claim type. So I'm just going to go in here and very quickly do a new claim type I'm going to create. So this is me lighting up. If I can type department string. So this is a very typical one you would see possibly implemented, as opposed to having group memberships looking after that. So I'm going to say department, and then I can leave it so it matches the same name, or I can customize it. So in this case, I'm going to customize this by saying company department. You don't have to. And I'm going to say, you know what, let's light this up for both the users and also for computer objects. I can just leave it for users if I wanted to. Hit OK. And I'm going to make another claim, and this time I'm going to go in and make another one, which is employee type. I'm going to leave that one there as is and just leave it for, well, you know what, I'll turn on just for users, because only users can be employees. Computers can't be employees yet. Put them in. Once I'm there, I come back to the main level of dynamic access control, and then I go down to resource properties. And basically, you can see here for individual resource properties, this now again, resource properties are applied to folder structures, right? Folders and files. So here, I want to basically enable the attribute of department also associated with the folder structure. So again, I can identify that this folder is on the general public share. I'm not going to protect with NTFS permissions to say the group of finance. Instead, I'm going to say the attribute of department in Active Directory has to be lit up in order to be able to access this folder structure called finance, let's say, and use that as a restriction point. So basically, I'm going to light that guy up as a resource property, and that guy there is enabled. Then I'm going to go back to dynamic access control over here, and then up to the actual rules, and let's create our first rule. You have to have one rule before you can make a policy.
Department have to be populated, or is there populated with a specific department?
Now, the trick is it needs to be populated with something. Otherwise it's blank, because you actually are going to be putting in where department equals and then drop-down box what it is.
Right.
It actually is able to go in and query your Active Directory and see what the different options are that have already been populated so far or blank. You're going to want to make sure you obviously put the proper data inside the fields to get there. So garbage in, garbage out. You got to clean up stuff to be able to use this first.
Sure.
Right?
But what's going to happen if it's left blank?
If it's left blank, then department equals blank is the only option you're going to have.
Which is going to be fine, meaning it's going to treat it the same as if we say department needs to equal sales, and department equals blank just means it's blank.
You can actually
meaning it's not sales.
You can actually say department equals blank to say, you know, if anyone that's not classified with a department, give them a catch-all of no access.
Okay,
if you wanted to. So over here, I'm just going to go up here and say central access rule, lack of creativity. Central access rule, and then the rule is going to basically have the resources. I'm going to be going in here and add a condition, and my condition is going to say where resource and department equals a value, and the value is going to be from Active Directory research and development. So that's already populated inside my AD. It's all good to go. Hit OK.
And it got that by querying what are the things that are currently populated.
Yep. And then I have the ability to go down here and say under permissions, use the following permissions proposed as proposed, which means don't actually kick people out, but simply log the events, which is the way I'm going to leave it. And then down below, you can see if department equals R&D, apply the following. Owner get full, built-in administrators get full, anti-authority system gets full control. Well, let's get rid of administrators just so that the R&D department feels good that their secrets are safe with them. And I'm going to add in authenticated users.
Because their stuff's definitely safe.
Well, no, and let me tell you why I'm using authenticated users. Because only authenticated users that have the attribute of department filled in equal to research and development.
That's right.
Will get the modify capabilities.
Plus you have their share permissions as no access.
Potentially.
Yeah.
It depends on how you have to have that set up. So once that's set up with your condition, that guy there is good. He's done. Hit OK. And basically, central access rule is done. Come back up over here to central access policy. New central access policy. And then simply enable it. And then I choose the rule. There's the central access rule I just created. Have it applied. Go in, hit OK. It's now part of my policy. So I can go through and test a whole bunch of different theories of my different rules. And then until they get included into the central access policy, maybe I'm going to have one which is like my testing one and one which is my production, in which case I can go and add these rules into my testing one, apply the testing one to my testing servers, see if the desired results are correct, and then I can migrate them from there into the final one, which is the final one. The next step, which I'm not going to do right now because of lack of time, is simply go into my group policy management editor, turning on central access policies to be applied through group policy, and then targeting which file servers by OU potentially are going to get these central access policies' ability to apply them, and that's it.
You know, there is one question that did come through, and it was something I was going to point out when you were on the demo. So actually, if you can pop back over to the screen where you were creating that new rule.
The rule or the policy?
The policy. Well, the rule. When you entered the value of that field needs to be sales.
Yeah.
Is there a drop down so that it can be, you know,
so you don't have to worry about
includes
human error?
Sales?
Yes. Yeah.
Or can you use wildcards? And or can you use wildcards?
You can use different expressions, ands and ors. Can't use wildcards. It's either an on or an off.
But you can use includes.
You can use includes.
Starts with.
Yeah.
That's why I'm curious if we can go. That's why I wanted to bring you back specifically to the demo. Can we pull that drop down?
Let me see if I
can
get there.
So we can all see everything. Just create another new one.
I'm just going to edit this guy.
There you go. Right there.
So this is the lit up attribute that I have created already, right?
Right.
I've got equals, any of, so, exists, not any of, does not equal, does not exist. There is no includes. And then a value. And then whatever the value happens to be. So you do have some level of any of, and you can put some any of requirements. I can go off and basically, it's in this case, only resource option, that's it. But what I can also do is I can have additional conditions and have ands and ors for other ones as well. So basically department equals research and development and employee equals full-time or part-time, not contractors, as an example. So you can have a variety of different combinations of my conditions added into the single rule and then apply them in.
Are you seeing this as being enterprise admin stuff only?
this is definitely on the more advanced scale. You're not going to be doing this if you're just starting off and if you're just managing file servers. This is something you want to be involved with the planning process if you do manage file access to stuff, for sure.
Well, and I'm not just seeing it as like a junior level admin isn't ready for this, as much as I can just see how complicated this is going to become when you have, you know, I don't want to call it a rogue junior admin, but you have someone off on their own trying to implement some of this dynamic access control in different directions, and then you got to go back and figure it out.
Yeah. So again, similar to how you should know the basics of how Active Directory works and, you know, how you can manage OU structures, that sort of stuff, you're going to want to get some more experience and years under your belt to understand the design principles where things are, more experience. Implementing access denied assistance. This is again through file server resource manager. How to go off and troubleshoot for text for the text for access denied. You get the basically at access time is user denied access, sees the message, and then has the ability to go off and to start some troubleshooting, or they can go down and do some other things. The data owner and or the help desk can be the destination of where this email goes to. Very simple stuff in file server resource manager if you have that option and the feature installed to be able to go off and to manage that. Last little bit about classification. Just a reminder that you do have the ability to do automatic classification with File Server Resource Manager. Now, because the files have additional attributes, which are resource property objects, which is part of your claims, you can now have it take action upon those. So if you have a classification rule that says, look for sensitivity attribute on my file folder structure, on my individual files, and that sensitivity attribute is now set to high, or low, or medium, whatever it happens to be, do something to it. Classify it as being something different, or go ahead and enact the rule to go in and start up the ADRMS engine to encrypt that and protect that guy from being able to leak out to go to different places. So that's also the last little bit about file classification. Kind of summarizing this, there's a demo I did for being able to create a central rule and central policy. To kind of summarize this, just to come back to this, really a matter of dip your toe in, understand the concepts of what's possible to be able to identify which attributes that you can use to light up and do claims against. Understand that they're applied to individual user claims, as well as to resource objects, which are file folder structures and objects in the physical file system that can have claims against their attributes as well. And then you combine them together with those claims into new optional conditional central access policy rules, which will be able to slip in as a third layer beyond share and NTFS and the new one of central access dynamic access control to grant or deny access to different individual resources. You don't necessarily need to have that big massive structure. It's maintaining all those different group memberships for who you are, what you do, and where you live and stuff like that by simply having a group membership which quickly go out of date. I know that in my previous life and previous job before joining Microsoft, I'd be belonging to groups that I should not be belonging to Microsoft forever. I've worked in the real world too, in the outside world too. it was always a pain to have to remember, oh yeah, Joe moved for a secondment for 3 years over in the finance department and needs to be there for so long, that sort of stuff. And take him out of the R&D groups and put him into the finance groups and then remember to take him back out again when he's done, because we all have plenty of time to remember that sort of stuff, right?
Absolutely.
That's all I got for dynamic access, all the time that I have.
It's all in the steel trap. So since we are running out of time, but we have just a few seconds left, another quick show of hands. Who's excited about DAC?
Who's going
to try playing with it like 5 minutes from now?
You got it. There's some hands-on labs you can go off and try online.
Yeah. The hands are popping up. I can see them already. I saw them earlier, too.
If you haven't had a chance to answer the poll question yet, last chance, you can do so during the break. Grab your mouse, vote in the poll.
Please do.
And join us.
Not my poll. The poll you see on the screen. Not the show of hands.
Yes. We will be back after the break talking about changes to Active Directory.
There's changes?
Yeah. All right. You should know them. We're going to talk about them.
All right.
After the break.
See you in a few.
See ya.